Okay.
Before I start, little confession. I have a very problematic relationship with academia. It's kind of love and hate. And the last time I was thrown out, it was so bloody, I don't think I'll go back. Although I never say never. And that kind of informs what I'm going to talk about tonight. The other thing is, in one of my other lives, I teach maths, GCSE maths, A-level maths, any sort of maths, private maths tuition, which gives me a kind of a take on what it means to be teaching. And the way I kind of understood the problem, because I'm a philosopher, is about what it is that schools do. And if you really want to understand what their function is in any modern society, and what technology might do, then it's a mistake to understand it in isolation, as a problem of a here and now. Because any philosopher worthy of his salt, or her salt, if you ask a question, will go, and start to talk about the Greeks. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to start with Greece, and then we're going to move across time, ending with some modern theorists of power and knowledge and engagement, and show you different ways the problem of education, schools, and engagement have been understood at different times, in different worlds. So, where do philosophers traditionally begin? It's not just with the Greeks. Is with three thinkers, Plato, Aristotle, the one I'm going to start with. You see, 2,400 years ago or so, the great seismic event happened. That kind of defines philosophy. The trial of Socrates. And central to that trial was a moment. Socrates is on trial for his life. But this is a moment he turns on his would-be accusers and starts to torment them. They accuse him of corrupting the youth of Athens. I thought I said I educated them. But if you are the expert, Thrasymachus, can you tell me who do you think should educate the youth of Athens? It's obvious, the people of Athens. What? All of them? All of them! Oh, what lucky little fellows. The youth of Athens are. What have I been doing all these years? Why have I bothered educating anyone about anything?
But Socrates goes on to say,
but is this really right? I mean, do you educate a youth by showing him? Do you educate a horse by showing him broken-in horses? Do you make a pot by showing him clay pots? Or do you trust the art of craft to those who have spent a lifetime learning that art? Who then do you think should educate? The people of Athens, who don't give a hoot about their youth, or a man who has spent his life trying to understand how to teach? Now, Socrates is really onto something. The point he's making is that there are two ways you can understand education. In the Greek world, you could argue for the arts. On the one hand, you have the Thrasymachus, Menelaus kind of level. Education is about initiation. You're paying your price. When I'm teaching kids GCSE or A-level, I always say, you're a mistake if you think this is just about education. This is an initiation point. A university is kind of like the dear old Mekonaku, who lock 19-year-old kids in a box for a year. Or the Yamaneno, who have an initiation rite where they break their arm. What we do is we make you do maths GCSE. I mean, how else do you do it in a technological society? That is the Thrasymachus' view. And in reply, Socrates is putting a very different view. For him, education. Do you not see? Knowledge is good. Good is virtue. Virtue is freedom. Depend upon it. All evil comes from ignorance and stupidity. So I say to you, the unexamined life. And so it has seemed to me, throughout these long years, I was put here by some sprite or god, to be, as it were, your trainer. teaching you to think, showing you how to be free.
In a nutshell, education, any education, universities, schools, initiation rite versus an attempt to understand freedom, understand and so set your mind free. Except, of course, it wasn't that simple. The trial was written by Plato. He was a founder of an academy which had its own initiation rites. And that argument of Thrasymachus that education is just initiation depended on knowledge. The point was, both of them were justifying something that was already more complicated than they were talking, than they thought they were talking about. And you still have those two movements in education. At the moment, as a maths teacher, I'm peculiarly aware of it. Probably none of you know, maths GCSE is going from one pole to the other. About 3 years ago, the last legacy of the new Labour government was to create the best maths GCSE that I've ever taught in 25 years. It's the one that actually makes maths useful, that makes kids think for themselves. But surprise, surprise, Michael Gove didn't like it. And so it's being replaced by something that's just an initiation rite that wouldn't have disgraced maths O-level as Michael Gove took it in the 1950s. It's an act of crass intellectual vandalism. I'm revealing myself as a Socratean there. But the point is that this debate analyzes any way we try to understand how you educate, so that headmasters' careers are made or broken by it. That argument of Greece that saw ultimately knowledge and schools linked to research centres where people were trying to be free, and also temples, I suppose, where people were being initiated, didn't last in the ancient Greeks or Roman too. And it was swept away by the medieval view. Now, the medieval view of scholarship depended on a world that was different. Far less texts. Books were a rarity. But yet, unlike the Greek world, which was divided up in between those people who understood things and slaves, and the slaves kept the people who understood things alive, the point about Christendom was that everybody had to be part of the debate. And once everybody is being part of the debate becomes much more dangerous and difficult. So the role of universities, Oxford, Cambridge, and Sorbonne, was actually to define questions. Schools then, any school, business schools, are about defining what you can ask. Saying that is a heresy, you can't do that, and allowing other ones. Within that, the role of masters, which was traditionally to provide answers, was almost secondary to that ability to question. An ability to define, if you like, the idea hoard. The problem, of course, came when different questions were ruled legitimate by different schools. As a rule, and I'm not going to encapsulate all of medieval philosophy very quickly, but it came down to this. There were two approaches. On the one hand, there was an attempt to understand the world by what you knew. And on the other, there was an attempt to say, you don't know anything, and to prove that other people didn't know anything. That second one won. So that Christendom kind of collapses into a stupor of despair around about 1400. The universities become split and divided between those people who say, you can't know anything, let's walk away from the whole thing. That's Occam and his razor. Don't believe anything metaphysical. Only believe what you see. And those people who thought you could learn about the world, see about things beyond. The problem then with a question-based approach is that it's actually very hard to define the set of questions you can ask. But perhaps that's why you have schools to do it. That's kind of religious. We're defining what you can think. Moving quickly on. And this one goes much more directly, perhaps, to this issue about schools and about what it means to have a school. Because once you get the end of medievalism, say about 1470, you get two theories, deep theories, about organisation. And their most engaging, I suppose, exponents are Machiavelli and Law.
Now, Machiavelli is one of those people who you'll know one book but not the other. I say the name, and those of you who know anything a bit about philosophy will know that Machiavelli wrote a book called The Prince. And The Prince was the ultimate manual for a politician. A politician has to be subtle in his statecraft, not very scrupulous. He must always think of his dignity and act so that his dignity might be guaranteed. Universities then must act in their own interest. But Machiavelli's point is this, is that if you are somebody who has a prince who's good, you're actually quite happy, because part of the interest of a prince is keeping his people happy. He's always tiger riding. He's about three decisions away from a revolution. And although he must always think about his dignity, he must think about his people second to that dignity. So you're kind of a model, but on one level it's totally unprincipled, but it's only unprincipled because beneath it lies chaos. Kind of a theory of government practice, like almost never everything is chaotic. It is crisis management, but crisis management with an idea of serving an institution. That was on the one hand. Machiavelli wrote a second book. The second book is A Theory of Democracy. That theory of democracy, called The Discourses, uses history to show there's another way you can understand organisations. They don't have to be top-down things governed by a prince who must govern for his own benefit. They could be bottom-up. They could come up from the streets. They could be an immanent force that can organise and reorganise and rethrow everything. And Machiavelli puts his finger on the problem with any revolution, but also any attempt to have a top, a bottom-up approach. You don't know what you're going to get. You could get a wonderful state, a utopia, but you could just get bloody anarchy. So he puts the problem, you're going to risk it. The point is, he's saying, is that any organisation, a prince, is certainly know what you're going to get. Once you start getting rid of that, once you start having a chaos where everybody's just doing their own thing, just engaging and hoping the whole thing coheres, you really don't know where it's going to go. A little bit later, Thomas More has exactly the same argument, but he puts it the other way around, really. The book I'm thinking of is another one that gets widely read as Utopia. Now, if you're a kind of a slightly lefty idealist like I have been, and I probably am again, you will read Utopia and you will side with the Utopians, who live a very Spartan life, very well organised, very monkish. And the Western world seems a bit kind of crass, really. And yet, hidden in the book of Utopia, Moore has a justification for universities, for scholarship, for this kind of idea of an elite, separate world. As Will was talking about universities being apart, because he says it's only by being apart, and that being a part, being supported by something like private property, that you can actually have beautiful abstract knowledge that others can actually then use. It's that very separation that gives academic organisations, schools, their power. And once you start querying that, you don't know where you're going to go. You don't know whether you're going to get anything better. That idea of what's the point of a school, maybe it's about defining what you can think about, becomes very important about 100 years later, 17th century. And I'll give you three moments from that. The first is one of my favourite 17th century things. By the way, 17th century thought is my speciality. I can go on and on and on about 17th century thinking, but don't worry, I'm not. I'm going to give you three thinkers for three moments, all revolving around this question about what is the point of debate in schools, whether you can have a debate, whether you can have a form of understanding that is genuinely coming from practice, or whether you need a school. The first one, in fact, the first two you will again are fairly well-established philosophers, although I'm using them in our context. First one is Hobbes. quick recap.
Hobbes is the man who says, life is nasty, brutish, and short, without a state. So a state of nature is chaos. And you have to have an organisation, a body that is capable of organising it, because it's better than the alternative. And you can't have an open system, because that will devolve into an anarchy. But why? The important thing is why. Why Hobbes would be very mistrustful of any system of government, of management theory that had a listening management, talking to its people. It's very straightforward. He would think it was either self-undermining or pointless. Let me explain. The point of government for Hobbes, the point of schools, is to set the assumptions by which the entire system starts to move forward. Once we all share assumptions, once we all know what we're talking about, we're all speaking the same language, we can actually agree. The problem in the state of nature is that nobody knows what they're talking about because my words and your words don't have to have the same meaning. So our debate can go endlessly far from ourselves and we can be caught in a world of perpetual criticism. That's the point about perpetual criticism. Well, it's very easy to critique somebody if you just simply say, all your words have different meanings, all my words are better. Then of course you're caught in a perpetual state of war, straight Hobbes. The point then about a school, the point then about a university, the point is to create the initial assumptions on which thought is then built up, based, and worked through. That's Hobbes. The alternative side would be very much on the side of practice, and that's Locke. So Locke would say, a state of nature, a state of abundancy. But in order for humans to guarantee their wealth, they need minimal cooperation. So theorists you mentioned, whose name is temporarily forgotten, the management theorist who thinks you can go both directions, is really working in a Lockean tradition, where you can have organisations that come together by free reasoning individuals, and they're cooperating insofar as they all gain something by it and through it. And it's kind of an open, porous system. Maybe. But for my money, that Hobbes problem is still a problem. Which is why I've come to my third thinker. Again, paying attention. Spinoza. Those of you who never see my performance might not know that Spinoza is my great philosophical love. He writes this incredibly subtle stuff. Very subtle philosopher from the mid-17th century. He was originally Portuguese, ends up in the United Provinces, so he's living in the old in The Hague. And he's the man for whom the phrase pantheism was invented. He doesn't use it himself, it's invented to understand it. So me and God, God in me. And critical to Spinoza's analysis is a very deep problem about the nature of knowledge. Spinoza will say there are two sorts of knowledge. Both Hobbes and Locke are fundamentally right. They're not contradictory, but that's the problem. So on the one hand, in order to be able to start understanding things at all, you've got to start off at an arbitrary level. You've got to have somebody say, this means that means that, that's it. So you've got to have a management that's capable of giving assumptions. But on the other level, once one actually starts engaging with the world, once one actually starts being practical, one actually reaches out to one's fellow man, and two individuals are more capable of creating strange little unions, they're capable of creating new thoughts, feeding backwards and forwards, one with the other, so that the management and the workers, for better or for want of other words, actually can communicate with each other and gain more by it. But the problem, what Spinoza would say, is that sometimes it's very hard to tell these two worlds apart. Once you actually start in an exchange, you might move the mood of music just a little, and the same exchange could feel like an arbitrary relationship, could feel antagonistic. In a sense, it's only because both sides know that they are exchanging. They know that the thing is dynamic. That makes it an exchange at all. And so Spinoza's point is, it's actually very difficult to keep that kind of thing going. It's very easy then for that kind of founder or from somebody to outside saying that's not an exchange at all. What they hear is arbitrary and unjust and just the same. So the 17th century view of that kind of debate about schools is that the role of a school is to define what you can, is to define where you're going to start the debate. Its aim is to create free associations between individuals. The question is whether you can actually ever go between them. The left in the course of the 17th century with endless bloody wars, but no. Period. Final two thinkers. And then I'll just talk about three modern theories and then we're done. I'm going to go a little further forward to the other end of the Enlightenment and give you two arguments about why. Two arguments about what academia is doing, let's put it that way, and why schools see themselves apart and why they understand themselves as something separate. The first is human. Now, Hume is another one of those philosophers. He's kind of badly understood, but widely known. So, if any of you know anything about philosophy, you might know the name Hume. He's the man who kind of presents a rather damning argument against all proofs of God's existence. And also famously says that all of reality has to be defined by perceptions. And the further you get away from perception, the less you can be guaranteed that the reality of anything, which means abstract ideas like God or the self, become increasingly tricky. Now, Hume doesn't quite say that. He doesn't quite say that. He actually says reality is the difference between memory and reality.